looks like today. I just last minute, Eric and I decided to put in a few more things in this. Okay. So this is another another discussion of. So that's another discussion of keywords, grammar for your McStas instrument file that lets you do things beyond what you can do in, let's say, the linear approximation of one component at a time. I'll talk about split, extend, when, copy, and group, and then the very dangerous jump. Be warned, be warned. So, as you have seen, we have a syntax. Whenever you put a component, you put a component, you put the name of the component, and then the type and parameters. And then you've seen some of these already. You've seen that you have add and rotated. You can specify what they are with reference to. I believe we used already. Did we use extend? I think you saw extend already. But we have a number of these here, including a split, which is something you put in front, extend to put some extra C code there, a group here, and then a jump. We also have a conditional, so a when. So this means that you can actually turn parts of your instrument file off if you want. Good. The first of these that I'll discuss is the split. And this should also be used with a bit of caution. So it's intended to increase statistics. So if you have a costly simulation of your primary spectrometer and you arrive at your sample, maybe you could actually reuse the information in one of the neutron rays for multiple processes, because as we know, in the samples, we can both scatter and we can be transmitted and we can be absorbed and so forth. In a sample that has a lot of different reflections, it's possible that this neutron event would actually have a possibility of scattering on multiple lines. So why don't we take this into account? So it's a variance reduction technique. And what it will do is that it will formulate kind of an if statement in your instrument file. So you have an N here, you write split N and then component, etc. And that will formulate an if statement. So for J equals 1 to N, you do actually a repetition of the remaining part of the instrument file N times. The idea is then that the arriving neutron at that time is repeated in N identical copies, of course with a renormalized intensity, right? So you have, instead of having one that has intensity I, you get N of an intensity I divided by N. So it's not that we will corrupt our intensity as such, we will simply boost the statistics available to the Monte Carlo in this part of the instrument. This is of course only meaningful if there is anyone to come afterwards. So this means we should do this only in front of a complicated component that actually includes Monte Carlo choices. Otherwise, all you will gain is an increased runtime, because the calculation will be identical for the N copies of the neutron. So yeah, you have to be cautious when to use this. Another rule of thumb is you need enough statistics in front of the sample. So it means it's hard to quantify in a very rigorous way, but I would say typically you would still probably want millions of events in front of the sample before adding this kind of thing. Okay. So it has to be used with sufficient statistics. That being said, nothing prevents that in, say, a triple axis, you do a split on the monocomator, you do a split on the sample, and you do a split on the analyzer. Nothing prevents you do that. You should, of course, think then of the dimensionality. Usually, at least something like a factor of 10, that's the default. So if you put split and no number here, we will split by 10. That's the default. If you have a power line, a set of power lines, or if you have a single crystal with many, many, many reflections, maybe that number is actually relevant here. One thing that helps you a little bit is that power n and single crystal will actually measure the statistics. It will check how many, how many possibilities are available on average. So if you do a short run first, it will say, this would be better if you did a split 50. So then the suggested value is a safe value to use. Okay? So what we have is one incoming neutron here, which is actually duplicated a number of times, so in this case, 4, which ends up in 4 scattered neutrons because of this kind of trick. So that's an efficiency in the statistics of architecture by a factor of 4. Good. So one of the things where this has been used with great success, that's actually for the macromolecules, because, well, they don't have 10 or 100 reflections. Macromolecular crystals have hundreds of thousands to millions of reflections. They think that my nice rubidoxin is a toy protein. Okay, that's just a toy. It cannot be used by anything scientific. So this means that our physics model intended for things like IPCO or, you know, aluminum oxide, just a few atoms, that algorithm really needed this kind of boost by a split. So what we do inside the single crystal is, in fact, we discussed the laying out of reciprocal space with respect to one incoming neutron, doing the Ewald construction, and then choosing among the possibilities with a Monte Carlo choice. This is what the single crystal does. So a lot of the calculation in the single crystal is, in fact, this initialization of reciprocal space. And what we do now is that we do a simple check. I just got a neutron. Is it identical to the one I had before? Given a certain criterion. So identical means we check, essentially we check all the parameters of the neutron state, if they are the same. If they are the same, we can actually skip this whole initialization and reuse the probabilities from the reciprocal space and just go directly to the Monte Carlo choice. So in the case, I actually don't have the improved numbers here, I think, or maybe I have it in a couple of slides, but for this rubidoxin scattering pattern here, this was run on, dating back a few years, but on 25 nodes on a compute cluster at DMSC in Copenhagen. I think they have 12 cores per node, a neutron count of 10 to the 12, and unfortunately that took something like 30 hours to complete on a big machine. So this really shows that this problem of macromolecular crystals, that's really computer intense. So as I was explaining before, the original algorithm in the single crystal would take one incoming neutron and scatter one outgoing, but with this little trick, this one is coming in. Let's say it's the first of a set of neutrons that was split. We simply store the value of that, and then when we look at the next one, then we won't scatter on the red, we might scatter on one of these blue instead. So it means that basically you have an improvement on the gain statistics on the detector by a factor of split. So in this case here, in rubidoxin, you could actually say that you could, to gain the same statistics in the detector, you could run 1/50th of the time. One factor of 50 less in the n count of 10 to the 12. Of course, it comes still at a cost, because the remaining part of the single crystal calculation, the Monte Carlo choice between the reflections and the final adjustment of intensity, etc., this of course remains. But, But the costly part of laying out reciprocal space is this we can save for the n minus 1 copies of the split neutron. Okay. Then we have something called the group. Did we see that? I don't think we saw that really before. So the idea is that you can have components that work in parallel. I think something fell out here. Maybe it was just suppressed. Of course, you can't just have an at. So you need a component, something. So this could be, it was, it's probably a monochromator. It says IN6 monox here. I would guess that's the monochromators of the IN6 at IL. So one is offset in position from another one. So they work in parallel. And the way group works is that you try to scatter on the first neutron. If you scatter, then you leave the group. So that's a normal reflection on one of the back peaks of this monochromator. If it is not scattered, it means it was either absorbed or transmitted or something like that, then it has a second chance of being used. So then it goes to the next one and so forth. So it formulates an XOR, an exclusive OR of these components. They will work in parallel, so you choose one or the other. Okay. And we repeat this process until we scatter. And if we are at the end not scattered, well, then the neutron is actually removed. So it's not that it doesn't have any side effects to use this, but that's the case with all of this advanced grammar, that you have to know how it works to really apply it successfully. Then I believe, at least in one of the instrument files, you saw extend. So let's say we have the same example. We have this group of monochromators here. And maybe we would like to later on study where this neutron that arrives at our sample, where did this scatter on the monochromator? Maybe something like that. So we introduce a flag. Like we did yesterday with the declare and the initialize. Maybe you have a myvar here, and myvar can then be put to 1 or 2 depending on what happens to the neutron. So this means we have a flag that we can access later on, which is not really a normal neutron parameter, but something else. So I think in vitesse terms, they have something called color, and this is about the same. So you can assign a flag or color depending on what happens. Good. So this is very powerful, used together with something called the when. The when allows you to have a component which is conditional. So this component here is of a certain type. Then you have when and a C expression at. It means that only if what is in the parentheses here evaluates to true, will I do anything? So used on a monitor with the kind of flag I showed you before, you can then decompose what is scattered from in the sample based on what happened at the monochromator. So you can study correlations that are, you know, otherwise not immediately accessible. Yeah. Good. So in the syntax of the example from before, you will have a monitor here, which is a PSD monitor, where my bar equals 1, and then this means that it only measures something if it's scattered on the first monitor. This is the way it's used. Okay, so now danger, Will Robinson. This is really scary stuff. So we're just physicists, right? We did have a computer scientist that in the beginning designed McStas the way it was supposed to be, really clever guy. This, I think, is probably the one thing we did that he thought we shouldn't do. Okay, so we of course introduced a go-to, right? So if you talk to a computer scientist, no, don't do go-tos. It's a break of the flow of your program, which can have unbelievable consequences. It's just stupid to have a go-to. I'm sorry, we introduced one. So you can do the syntax is like this. You have a component, and then you have a, con- uh, a conditional here. So when this expression is true, we can actually jump somewhere else in the integral file via a go-to. And we do install a little bit of safety, so you can jump to the same component or an arm. And that's to try just a little bit to limit, let's say, the consequences of combining the power with something strange. And the very dangerous thing about it is that we don't apply proper coordinate transformations when moving from one component to the next. So it's kind of it's a teleport. It's a magical. So I stand here and now I jump over there. Okay. So that means if the local orientation is different, well, rotations and translations are implicit. So a rule of thumb when using this: jump between arms that coincide. If you do that, it's less dangerous, that's for sure. Good? Yeah. So it is a go-to. And there's an XKCD comic here. I could restructure the program's flow or just use one little go-to. Screw good practice. How bad can it be? And then it's eaten by a dinosaur. You know? That's what happens when you use a go-to. You should avoid go-tos. Okay, but we have one, and now we know. Then we also have, and this we discussed already in the earlier talk. If you have a frog, you have a frog in your instrument file, and maybe you want another frog. So you just do a copy here. You can even do a copy on the naming. Then this will automatically generate a name that's different from that one. You can also have a frog with a different skin, so then you have to specify the skin here, of course. Multiple frogs in your instrument file, this is possible via the copy key. And that was this environment. And now I think it's time for you to work.